get as loud as you want to get. You can get caught up in the worship. You can get caught up in the praise. We have no problem with it. We want you to be a part of it. We want you to worship God. We want you to honor God. We don't want you to keep your mouth closed, because I'm going to tell you now, I used to play ball down in New Orleans. I used to play pro ball. I used to play semi-pro ball. And I'm going to tell you now, even when I played high school ball, my mama sometimes kind of scared, because she would run down the stadium hollering my name as I played ball. And she would get real loud. And when she get to church on Sunday after we played on Thursday, it seemed like she got louder on Sunday than she was on Thursday. And what I'm saying is that if we can get excited for the things that we want to get excited about, we should be exceptionally more excited when we get into the house of God. And I'm not just saying that to my friend. I'm saying it to all of you this morning. Now, I know last Sunday, and I know in Bible class y'all were loud. I'm expecting y'all to be louder. But I need y'all to have the right loudness. Am I making sense? If you be loud, and that's all you is. And I understand the correct and proper way, that's all you are. But that's all you is. It's loud. There's nothing in it. There's nothing behind it. So I want you to really rejoice today. I want you to really get into what God has for us. So the woman of God has been in prayer all this week from what she has shared with me. And she's ready to give God what God has given her. She's ready to break forth the bread of life and share the word of God with us today. How many of y'all really came to receive something from God today?
Amen. Amen.
How many of y'all really want the Lord to bless you today? You came expecting. You came looking for a word from the Lord. You desired something of the Lord. One thing David said, I desire of the Lord, and that will I seek after, and I will inquire in his temple. Is that right?
Amen.
How many of y'all know sometimes you got to go to the house to get from the house?
Amen.
Is that right? You can't just always call the house, but you got to go to the house. And we're at the house of the Lord. I understand that we are in a house. But this portion of the house has been set aside and dedicated unto the Lord. It literally has been so dedicated so that, from my understanding, they won't allow any and everything to go on in this room to make sure that it stays sacred unto God, so that when Sunday comes, when Wednesday comes for Bible class, it don't have all of them spirits caught up in it. And it's not just this room, but they try to make sure that every room in this house is still dedicated unto God. They watch what is played. They watch what is sung. They watch what is done, so that when Sunday comes, you ain't fighting to be able to get into the Spirit of God.
Amen.
But the Spirit of God now is waiting for you to stop fighting and let him in.
Amen.
Is that right?
Amen.
See, that's the thing that happened. We come in there, so many spirits that's in the house, because we let so many things go on in the house.
Amen.
Even in the houses that been built, we let some of everything go on, and then when time for worship to go forward, you wonder why it take Rev so long for him or her to get where they need to get, and why the psalmist is taking so long, and when the sermonic selection is going forward, it takes forever and a day for the Spirit of God. Well, what were you fighting with before you got there? Did you consecrate the house unto God?
Amen.
So we are grateful. I'm ecstatic. I'm excited, as you can tell. And I'm going to be honest, there are times you won't be able to tell how excited I am, but today I'm excited because I'm grateful for everything that God has done. But I'm more grateful that when I get an opportunity to get fed and not just feed, it's even greater.
Amen.
How many of y'all know it's good to preach, but it's also good to be preached too?
Amen.
So today we're getting ready to do that. We're getting ready to get a word from God. God is getting ready to take us to the next level. He's getting ready to take us into a new dimension. And here the thing of it is, as we talk on Friday night in joy service, I just feel led to say this again. Some of us just need to stop crying and start rejoicing. Recognize our Sanballat and our Tobiases that are trying to trap us, that are trying to hold us down, that are trying to pull us into things and kill the spirit that God had placed in us, that is trying to stop us from doing the work that God had called us to do. Tobias and Sanballat, they've already wrote their letters, they have conspired with their friends, and they have literally tried to fight you, and they've literally been fighting you, and you didn't recognize the fight that was going on. And I'm trying to get us to the place to understand that when you get to the place and recognize when God has brought you out, the word of God has convicted you and is starting to convert you, and in conversion you have now got up and you move from the place you were, stop crying because God has shared with you what you were wrong. Now get up from the fact that you recognize that you've done wrong and start moving forward and rejoicing, because God has delivered you, God has forgiven you, God has healed you. Now begin to move forward. So stop crying. You recognize where you went wrong, so stop weeping over it, baby. Get up. Brother, stop moaning and groaning and still complaining, and start rejoicing. You can't say the joys and losses, your strength, and God done convicted you because you done done so wrong, you done told a lie, you done committed a sin, but he done forgave you for it, and you still beating yourself up for what you done did. Get up!
That's right.
Go forward! Mm-hmm. And rejoice. Amen. So I just want us to recognize that today, as I get ready to bring up the woman of God today, as we get ready to break forward, I want to introduce to some, and I want to present to others, a woman, a minister of an hour, a preacher of the day, and that being in the person of Minister Kendra Morgan. She's going to come and she's going to bring forth the bread of life to us today. She's going to give us a word in its season. She's going to teach, she's going to preach, she's going to minister unto our hearts.
Man.
That we might be able to, by the wayside, hear a word from heaven.
Yes.
That God might bless us and move us forward.
Mm-hmm.
So as we get ready to receive this word, if y'all will, help me with this song, if you will. Father, I said, my to thee.
Come on, y'all.
No!
Are y'all ain't gonna help me?
I don't
know. The help I know if thou with God thyself from me, oh, where shall I go?
One more step. What did Minister Kendra? I told y'all in the country.
We country. That's how we used to say it back in the fall. Yeah. That one I just didn't know. Right. You get on one knee. Just me and I want to do something a little different. I'm going to give y'all what we're going to say, and I'm going to move on out the way. But I need to do something. I got to change this up. Because I'm a person that I like my young people. I need y'all to come for that back up to the front. Come on.
Uh-oh.
Come on. Christian, Kaya, young ladies, come up here by your mama. Come on. If you have to move a chair up, but I need to make sure y'all get this. This is not just for our old people as we think this. It's for everybody. Come on, Mom. All right. Thank you. Thank you for being obedient. Even if you didn't want to do it, but you did it out of obedience. So thank you. Because this morning, this is not just for us. This is for you too. What God gave me is going to help you along the way, just like this one helped me. Grandma and Mama, Pastor Mama, Evangelist back here. It's for all of us. Whenever we come to church, it's not just meant for Mama to come and get fed. It's meant for us to be fed too.
Amen.
When God talks to the house, he talks to the whole house. He don't talk to just one person.
Come on,
right. Because if he talk to one person, that means y'all going starving. And if you starving, you see what people look like on TV when they starving? Mm-hmm. They don't look healthy, do they?
No.
They undernourished?
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, and I'm going to show you something because I'm looking, I'm going to go on to the word. But sometimes whenever you look at TV and they show Africa, they show us the hard parts of Africa.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And when you see these people, you see swollen stomachs.
Mm-hmm.
Because these people aren't getting enough of food.
Right.
Sometimes whenever you see over in India, they show you where the little kids are not getting fed. They're giving them rice.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it's just a small bowl of rice.
Uh-huh.
But we got enough of food. How many of y'all can go to your refrigerator and go open your refrigerator and stand. Because when I was a child, I know I used to do it. Stand in the refrigerator. Mom would be like, you didn't put that refrigerator. You been in that refrigerator a few minutes ago. Same thing you know was in there a few minutes ago. Did you do it?
Amen.
All right, you go and close the refrigerator. And you go and sit in front of the TV. And then it clicked with you.
Sandwich, man. I'm going to make that sandwich.
You go in the refrigerator. Open the refrigerator again. You don't open the drawer where the food meat at. You just stand there. Then you go back and have a seat and say, I need a soda. You go back to the refrigerator. Is it a soda in the refrigerator? Not all the time. We don't have soda. Sometimes we got Kool-Aid and we got juice. Mm-hmm. We got a preference and we got a choice when we go. Mm-hmm. So whenever we come in God's house, we got a preference and a choice to say thank you, because he didn't have to make that way for mama and daddy and whoever else we stand with to make that way for us to have that juice, that soda, that apple juice, that sandwich meat, them chips. I love chips, but I'm going to tell you right now, Mr. Kendra, look, cookie cakes, some pies. Can't you tell? I like cookies, cakes, and pies. And I will tell you when I go to the grocery store, I'll go to the cookie aisle to see what's new. But in order for me to do that, I got to work that job to go pay for it. I just can't go and get it off the shelf. So whenever I walk into the church, I'm thankful. Mm-hmm. And it's not just whenever I go to church. It's when I get up in the morning, I'm thankful.
Man.
I don't have the best job in the world. And trust me, when I tell you this, it gets on my nerves sometimes. Amen. But whenever I look at my kids and my kids want to give me a hard time, I tell them right quick, go to that light switch. Turn it off. They turn it off. Turn it on. They turn it on. I say, turn it off. Turn it off. Turn it on. Turn it on. Guess what? The mess I put up with in that job pays for that light bill that you can go and turn that light off, turn that light on, turn that water on, turn that water off. Mm-hmm. So guess what? Not only do God bless mom and daddy, he bless you too.
That's right.
Because you can't bathe with no water.
That's right.
We don't have to go. I had a cousin. It's a modern day. We had a new century. How many of y'all know what a bathroom is and you can go to the bathroom and sit down? You know what that is? Mm-hmm. But trust me, I'm sure your mama, your grandma, somebody don't know, realize that guess what? They saw where they came from to where they is now.
Come on.
Because I remember whenever I was about a woman age, my granddaddy didn't have an indoor bathroom. I had to learn what was an outhouse. But my mama had an indoor bathroom. But when you go to grandma and
grandma,
and you got to go outside.
Come on now.
And you looking around at this little hut. Oh, it was already there. He made sure you had that. But the thing of it is you sit on top of a hole.
Uh-huh. There you go.
A hole. Mm-hmm. As a child, trust me, I'm scared of bugs.
Yeah.
As a grown woman, I'm still scared of snakes. Uh-huh. I will run.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know what's in there because ain't no light in there.
There you go.
You know what, Mike? You got the cracks in the wall.
There you go.
Y'all don't have to experience that. Y'all ain't have to experience that. But guess what? We did.
Yeah, yeah.
Amen. And I caught the tail end of it, so imagine grandma and granddaddy and mama them having to do this every day.
Mm-hmm. Come on now.
Whenever we go and take our bath, we can turn on the hot water, right?
Mm-hmm.
Ask grandma and granddaddy and mama how many of them had to heat up water.
That's right.
That's right.
We don't know what that is. We haven't experienced that. God kept us from that.
That's right.
I know what it is to heat up water.
I know.
Anyway. So, on that note, be mindful. Be thankful.
Mm-hmm.
When you come into God's house, I don't care where it's at, where it's satisfied, be thankful.
Mm-hmm.
Because he didn't have to do it.
That's right.
Y'all go to school every day, right?
Mm-hmm.
When y'all get up in the morning, y'all get up, y'all get dressed, you ain't got to heat up no water, you ain't got to go out there and get no water, you go up to the bathroom and turn the water on, get dressed, and go to school. Am I right?
Man.
My kids got it so good. My 7-year-old one pulled her pancake on the stick and throw it in the microwave. Guess what? When I grew up, we didn't have microwave. Microwave came when I became a teenager.
That's right.
We had to turn the oven on to get it heat up.
Mm-hmm.
Then you got to put your food in and then you take it out. And don't forget to turn that oven off, because if you don't, guess what? You going to throw that oven on all day long.
Mm-hmm.
Then your mama fussing because now it's hot in the house. Mm-hmm. The light bill is going up.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all don't have to worry about that, baby. Because I know for a fact I got one to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and cook him a 4-course breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
And he ain't even got to heat up a stove. He got to go get no wood to heat up the stove to get this food done. He just went and turned on my stove and started cooking.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody didn't have that privilege, son, and somebody don't have that privilege now.
That's right.
Amen. Somebody don't have that privilege of getting out of bed and going to the refrigerator to get something to eat. You go to school every day with kids that parents don't even know where they're going to get their next meal from, and half the kids don't get a meal other than the meals they get at school.
That's right.
Be thankful.
That's right.
Be thankful, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And this ain't even work out. We're having me going. I don't even know what's going on with this. But, yeah, that's still, be thankful, okay? Now, the next thing we're going to do, I need you to open up your Bibles to Matthew 14, starting at the 22nd verse. Mm-hmm. And I moved y'all to the front because, in fact, if you stay back there, you miss everything. You're looking at each other. You want to look at your cell phone.
Mm-hmm.
You want to play with your tablet. And I know me, I used to want to write on paper. And that was my thing on Sunday. I always made sure I had my little notebook and I'd be ready to write. My mama got smart because me and my sister used to just pass the paper down to each other. She got smart. Well, then we got ready to go out the door on Sunday, she said, let me hold your pocketbook.
Wow.
You don't need this. You don't need that. I didn't realize until now that I'm a mom and I'm a mama. She was preparing me. So whenever I went to the house of God, then I received the word that was coming forth.
Right.
Because if I kept on having all the distractions and kept on being doing a little miscellaneous stuff, it wasn't that I was bad. It was just that I got bored.
Mm-hmm.
We just don't trust me. We get bored now.
Yeah, we do. Yeah.
But I'm going to help you out with getting bored, okay? This is where we're going to go. Matthew 14 and 22, starting at the 22nd verse. Alright. Christian, you want to read?
Sure. Stand up. And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him into the other side while he sent the multitude away.
Keep on. You
want to celebrate
the 31st,
right? 31st. And when he had sent the multitude away, he went up into the mountain for part pray, and when the evening was come, he was on the ground alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it is a spirit, and they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus sprang unto them, saying, be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And Peter answered him, and the Lord said, and Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. And he said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. And then Jesus stretched forth his hand and called him and said unto him, O thou a little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?
Amen. This morning we're going to use for a topic, don't lose focus. And for a subtopic, keep your eyes on Jesus. As we read in this particular passage of scripture, Jesus was dealing with some stuff himself because he had just found out that his cousin had got killed. And you know sometimes whenever you get bad news, you want to fix it yourself. You don't want to deal with people right away.
Right.
But because Jesus being who Jesus is, the followers of his cousin, which was John the Baptist, the followers were coming around. Everybody wanted to see what was going on, and he wanted to talk, and he started ministering to them, even though he was dealing with what was going on with himself.
Mm-hmm.
He still ministered to them, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But now, he spent, after everything was done and he fed the multitudes, y'all can go back and read it because this is not where I'm going. I want to take it somewhere else. But I wanted to bring you up to where we started. Well, after he sent them away and he went to himself, if you remember, that's where we started, the 22nd verse. He sent the disciples home. Go on ahead and I'm going to catch up with you. First of all now, this is me. If you're going to catch up with me and I'm in a boat, how you going to catch up with me?
Well, no.
No? At this time, you're not thinking about Jesus walking on no water. Think about it. You sent me ahead of you and said, I'm going to get up with you. Paraphrasing, that's not in Bobby. I know Jesus didn't talk like that, but that's how we talk. I'm going to get up with you in a little bit. How many of you talk to your friends and say, I'll meet you at the mall? Or I'll meet you at the movie theater? You looking for them to come in the car, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or you looking for them to catch the bus, right?
Mm-hmm.
We got transportation. They didn't have transportation now. So, whenever Jesus went out to himself and he prayed and he just went to go meet them, first of all, it was in the middle of the night because I went to see because I want to know what was the fourth watch. Fourth watch, what is that? The o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
So when I looked it up, it was like, it said that it was like 3 o'clock in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
3 o'clock in the morning. First of all, 3 o'clock in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
We done sailed and we far away from the land. You come. First thing gonna happen, I'm gonna be honest. I'm like the disciples. What is that? I work at nighttime. I work from 11 to 7 in the middle of the night. And I am one of the scariest people you will ever meet. I work with senior citizens. I deal with life and I deal with death. When I left my job on Friday morning, I talked to Pastor and I said, you know what? I got a resident. I would be surprised if she makes it to the end of this weekend. I picked up one of my friends from work. The very lady I said that I would be surprised she made it through the weekend died that same day.
Wow.
Now, me being me, every time I walk in that room, Lord, this lady's not breathing right. I need you to keep her warm until I get ready to get up out of here. First of all, that was me using my faith because I was believing that he was going to keep her there until it was time for me to go home.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what type of person I am. I'm a faith person. I believe in and some stuff that I just can't see. I believe in. And I'm going to show you how you believe in it, too. You don't believe me? You don't believe me, do you? You see this walking? Come here. You want this walking? You really want this walking? Reach your hands up and get it. See that baby reach his hands up? Now, he believes I'm giving him that walking. You want it? Come get it. Y'all laughing, I want you to see something. Come get it. Come on. Look at his eyes, though. This is what I want you to see. Look at his eyes. Hey, come get it. Did he take his eyes off that sparkle?
Yeah.
That's the demonstration I want you to see. There you go, back. That show was. You welcome. Now, this is what I want you to see. As children, we have faith as children.
Mm-hmm.
It's not called faith. But I'm going to teach you today, and I'm going to tell you exactly what it is. It's faith. You just haven't activated it yet.
Come on.
And I'm going to show you how you ain't activated.
Come on, show.
Whenever mama tells you something, you believe mama won't do it, don't you?
Amen.
I do. When your mama tells you something, do you believe she won't do it? You believe it? Or you just sometimes believe it? You believe it, don't you? You look for mama to do it, right? That's what God wants us to do whenever we tell him we need him to do something for us.
Mm-hmm.
He wants us to believe he's going to do it. Not all the time it might not come the way we want it to come.
Right.
Come on. But it comes the way he knows we need it to come.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Not every blessing come in money.
Come on.
Right. Not every blessing come in clothes.
Yeah. Right.
Not every blessing come in shoes.
That's right.
Because you know what? Sometimes over in the middle of the night,
mm-hmm.
and I had to learn this because I went to the doctor the other day. Being funny, talking to one of my homegirls back home. And I was like, girl, I just called to see how you was doing. The last time I talked to you, you were sick. And I wanted to make sure everything was going okay. And she was telling me what was going on with her.
So I went to her house and said, let me tell you something. She said, where you at? I said, I'm at the doctor. She said, you at the doctor? I said, yeah, I'm at the doctor. I said, girl, I believe in preventative care now. Mm-hmm. I don't wait until I get sick no more to go to the doctor. I believe in preventative care.
Yes.
Not realizing there was something going on in my own body.
Come on.
When I went to the doctor, I was running fever. Didn't feel like I was running fever. I mean, I didn't feel well, but I didn't feel like I was sick.
Uh-huh. Come on.
You get what I'm saying? You know when you're sick, you bent over, head hurting. And I know I caught the flu this year and never had the flu. That was one of the worst experiences I ever had, and I don't want it again.
Mm-hmm.
Well, from that to me having whatever this was going on with my ears and my sinuses and stuff, and I'm running fever when I got to the doctor. Now remember, I just told somebody, I believe in preventative care. I don't go to the doctor when I'm sick no more. I didn't feel sick until the doctor gave me the medicine.
Come on.
Wait a minute. Something wrong with this picture.
Uh-huh.
I was fine, and this is what I'm going to show you now. Remember whenever Peter asked Jesus, bid me to come and fetch you?
Come on.
Before Peter ever got out the boat, the wind was already blowing.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It didn't just start blowing when he started walking.
Uh-uh.
It was already blowing.
Yes.
So let me tell you something. When I walked up in that doctor's office, I told you I already didn't feel a little, I felt a little bad, but I wasn't feeling bad is what I say, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So, wait a minute. Now, I'm going to the doctor, and I already knew I had a doctor's appointment. I knew I wasn't feeling too well. But, I didn't feel bad. Until he told me, guess what? I done put my mind on this situation. I'm on a fever and my head is hurting. Wait, none of that stuff I acknowledge.
Come on.
None of that stuff I paid any attention to. So, wait a minute. I didn't start feeling sick until I started looking at her.
Uh-huh.
So, I was already dealing with the text that God was already giving to me.
Yes.
And I'm thinking to myself, man, well, what in the world? Did I get sick after I went to the doctor?
My.
It came to me. I started focusing on the situation.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of me keeping my eyes and my focus on him.
Yes. Well,
because if he kept me all that time before the doctor told me I was sick,
come on,
I shouldn't have accepted that.
Uh-huh.
I should have said, okay, Lord, now you said that you was going to heal my body now. And I believe that you took these stripes to keep me healed.
Yes.
So I'm going to keep on walking. I'm going to take this medicine that Dr. Ben gave me because I knew I wasn't feeling too good. But I'm going to keep on going. No, that ain't what I did. I got my medicine and guess what I did? I came home and laid down.
Amen.
Exactly. That's exactly what I did. So the purpose of what I'm trying to get you to see is you don't take the time to stay looking at what's going on. Because if Peter would have looked at the wind, he'd have never told Jesus to bid him to come.
Come on.
He'd have never got out.
Right.
Because first of all, why am I going to get out here in this wind up in the air like this? You might be walking on that water, but I'm not going to take that chance for me to walk on that water.
Right.
Come on.
But that ain't what he did. He said, if that be you, bid me to come.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Which means if he'd have kept his eyes on Jesus.
Come on, Otis. Yes, Otis.
If he'd have kept on him.
Yes.
Whenever that wind kept going.
Come on. Yes.
He might have.
Come on. Wait. Yes. Come on.
My.
If he did this.
Come on.
Straight on. But because he did. Yes, sir. Sometimes whenever you're sitting in school, and I know for myself that I had ADHD as a child, trust me, anything happened, I was looking. I wanted to see what it was, and I wanted to be a part.
Mm-hmm.
Not paying attention to that. If I pay attention to that teacher, whenever it comes time for that test, I ain't got to study hard, because guess what? Somebody in there didn't have to study as hard as I did.
Right.
Because of the fact they picked it up immediately.
Mm-hmm.
But because of the fact I was a person that was easily distracted,
mm-hmm.
it was harder for me to grasp something.
Come on.
So, and I say that is because sometimes when you're sitting in that classroom, and you know how it is, and Christian, you can speak for, mm-hmm. and I'm sure y'all can, howdy. Oh yeah, you definitely can speak for. You in high school. Oh, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
You in middle school, right? Yeah, you can speak for it too. Oh, you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you right about that time, because now they're starting to smell themselves at your age.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, you got that mouth report in your classroom, too. So you can identify with what I'm saying.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Even down to the little 6 and 7 year old, guess what? They have distractions too.
Right.
None of us are exempt. Okay? Mm-hmm. And I'm gonna give you some examples. I'm gonna help these grown folks out in a minute, but I want y'all to catch this too, because mm-hmm. it ain't just meant for them, it's meant for us too. Okay?
Yes. Right.
I'm gonna call the older people. It's not just meant for the older people, it's meant for us mm-hmm. young people too, okay? Now, when you're sitting in your classroom, and your teacher is telling you, the lesson today is, and we're going to do this in algebra. Y'all took an algebra? Y'all know what algebra? Algebra got a lot of steps, don't it? Okay? When I took algebra, I had a teacher that taught it to me, and she taught me this little phrase called, my dear Aunt Sally, which means multiply. Who?
Pimda.
Who?
Pimda.
What's that?
Can't
see my dear Aunt Sally. Yeah, you see what I'm saying? See what I'm saying? But we didn't do that one. I was with my dear Aunt Sally, which makes
wow.
us multiply, divide, and subtract. Them are a lot of steps. Them are a lot of steps. Think about it. Is it not a lot of steps?
Yes, it is.
You got to multiply and divide. Are you serious? I got to multiply and divide.
Alright.
Alright.
Come on.
What's the next step?
Emergencies, it's bonnets.
No. Right now, we're using this one. My dear Aunt Sally.
Oh,
Ed. Mm-hmm. Add and subtract. Alright? So we got to follow these steps. To multiply, divide, add, and subtract. Okay. Somewhere along the way, I had somebody sitting there. I'll never forget. Teacher was gone, substitute teacher there. This boy faked a seizure.
A seizure.
Mm-hmm. All of a sudden he got the shaking and everything. You see how you quick you started laughing? That's what we did. Ain't no way. The teacher had her back to us. And you know you gotta take this number and that number, still shaking. So y'all keep on laughing. And you gotta do this. That's what we was doing, not realizing that. While we laughing at him.
Mm-hmm.
We done missed some important information.
Right. Yeah.
Because he was too busy missing out on his education when we should have been getting ours.
Mm-hmm.
So, when I say lose focus, that was that win. Because whenever I missed that subtract them things,
yes.
and I decided that I wanted to go ahead and put equal,
mm-hmm.
it wasn't equal no more because why I missed the part. Mm-hmm. Because I was too tired up laughing at the boy that was taking the shoe seizure.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a wise thing to do.
No.
Don't lose focus, young people. Stay focused. Sometimes whenever we go to the store, mamas and daddies, Mrs. Twana, you can vouch for this because you said it was storming when you came from Macon.
Yes, Lord.
Your focus was on getting the church, wasn't it?
Yes, honey. I was denied.
Exactly. You were determined you were going to get here, right?
Yes, yes.
So that meant whenever the rain started coming, she kept on going.
Mm-hmm.
The rain still going, she kept on going. Trust and believe me, this house ain't Jesus, but trust and believe me. When she saw, she kept seeing that white house, and she wanted to get in that room with that red carpet, and she wanted to be where Jesus was sitting.
All right? Amen.
She didn't give up.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't focus that, okay, it's raining, Lord. I really want to be there, but I'm going to turn around and I'm going to go back home.
Mm-mm.
Don't give up. Sometimes we might have to slow down our pace.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we might have to ask a few extra questions.
Mm-hmm.
But don't lose focus, because it's the bigger thing at the end that's going to be important.
Yes. Right.
Whenever you get ready to walk down that aisle, and I always joke with Christian on this. Son, whenever you walk down that aisle and they say Christian Smith, and you go across that stage,
mm-hmm.
they might as well go ahead and tell the cop to escort me out that gymnasium, because guess what? His mama going to act the dunk. And the reason why I'm acting the dope, because I know.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. As a parent,
yes.
and to be a child that had struggles,
yes.
and it wasn't that I had hard struggles, it was struggles that I had.
Mm-hmm.
Because whenever you can't sit there and focus like you need to,
that's
a struggle.
Yes, mm-hmm.
And when everything around you catch your attention, that's a struggle. That's that win. And when you one of them kids, and I know I got one of these right here that's like taller. But I tell you, this is what I get, and a little soda asked me, please talk to Alana for talking. I got one that's a talker. Guess what? Talking make you miss out.
Yes, it does.
It make you miss out. It's the bigger picture at the end that you need. Because you can't go through life without an education, young people.
Come on.
Grown folks, if we turn around give up on everything that come our way, guess what? It's the bigger picture at the end we're going to miss out.
That's right.
It's the reward that we get at the end that we're going to miss out.
Hold on.
Guess what? Whenever, I'll never forget when Christian was about 3 years old. Mm-hmm. Christian had to go to a hospital.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to show you how persistent I was.
Come on.
First, I took him to the doctor. Fever of 103. Mm. I do healthcare for a living. Fever of 103? It ain't going that way. That's not good. That's starting to lead to brain damage.
Mm-hmm.
I took him to the doctor. Tylenol, ibuprofen. Okay? Next day, I got up. I'm doing everything that y'all telling me, and my child's still running fever.
Mm-hmm.
I take him back. We can't find anything wrong. His ears are not infected. His throat is not infected. He's playing, he's drinking. Something wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Third day. This day, I walk up in there. Now I'm determined. Because see, guess what? I could have took that word of that doc. Mm-hmm. And it could have been a mess at the end. And I'm going to tell you why it could have been a mess.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason why I stay focused. Because let me ask y'all, when God give you something,
mm-hmm.
you cherish the gift that you get.
Yes, right.
My child was my gift.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't ask to come here. I brought him here. He
mm-hmm.
was the gift that God gave me.
Yes.
So you know what? I guess that little metro, I had a little metro.
Mm-hmm.
I never forget. That joker shook every time he hit 55. He was going down the road. I was determined that I was on my way to make that 45-minute mm-hmm. drive. And when I got to that doctor's office, I looked at that doctor and I said, let me tell you something. I don't know what's wrong with him. But you better put him in the hospital. You better run every test that you need to run to get my child well.
Mm-hmm.
Got him there? Just put him in the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
Next day, all of a sudden, he done broke out with a rash.
Mm-hmm.
The doctor was an older doctor. He came in. Now, you know how you take your kids to the doctor, and you got this clinic with different doctors for your kids.
Mm-hmm.
Alright, this is what was going on. Different doctors were saying. But this particular day, this older doctor was on call and he had hospital.
Mm-hmm.
This doctor came in and he looked at Christian and looked over. He said, Mama, I think I know what it is. I said, okay, what is it? He goes to the computer, you know. Now we modernized mine.
Mm-hmm.
Used to the doctor had to go to the book.
Mm-hmm.
Now they just type it in on the computer
mm-hmm.
and it come up what the diagnosis is. He come back in and he give me this paper. I read the paper. I said, sir, I can't pronounce this. What is this? He said, it's called Kawasaki disease.
Nah.
First of all, that's a motorcycle.
Come on.
That ain't no disease. That's a motorcycle.
Mm-hmm.
He said, Miss Morgan, he said, I'm glad you was persistent. And I was like, why you say that? He said, because most kids die from this.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Thank you.
And I looked at it and I said, why is that? He said, because in the diagnosing phase, it's too many stages that the body has to go through before the diagnosis can be made.
Wow.
And what it was a disease that was a virus that attacks the heart.
Mm-hmm.
But it also attacks the immune system.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, you got, first of all, he wasn't digging at his ears. You know mamas when they get them kids and they be digging at their ears. You be like, oh, he got an infection. I'm taking him checked. The ears open flame, throat inflamed. All of a sudden you run a high fever. But whenever he explained it to me, because it's a process
mm-hmm.
that you go through. A lot of people don't live through the process.
Wow.
They tend to die.
Mm-hmm.
Then I'm looking at the fact that this is commonly in males.
Mm. Wow.
Wait a minute. I ain't got but one child. Well, we ain't gonna take my baby.
Mm.
He said, I know what to do. I know how to treat.
Mm.
He said, in a couple of days, he'll be all right. He
mm.
said, you something. I thank God because my mama taught me how to pray.
Yes.
And I used my prayer life to pray for my child.
Come on.
And even when I was going back and forth to the doctor,
mm-hmm.
I kept my eye on God. I said, Lord, I need you to take care of my baby.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what's wrong.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That's how we are in our life as adults and as children.
Mm-hmm.
We have to trust in God to do what he say he's going to do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because I'll never forget that morning when my child rolled over and my son started singing, oh, happy day.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever he sung that, I sat up in the hospital bed and looked at him. I said, he well now.
Yes.
He is well, honey. And I thank God for it because you know right now he can't tell that testimony, but I can.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You get what I'm saying?
Yes.
Because that means something to me. Whenever I know that I got situations going on, as determined as I was to get him well and better, and for them to figure out what's wrong with him, I got to be determined in my life now as an adult to know that I can make it to the next level.
Okay.
So that means whatever comes,
come on,
whoever friend that I had to have to go,
yes.
Guess what? Go on.
Uh-huh.
Go on, because I gotta stay focused.
That's right.
Because and whenever it all comes down to it,
mm-hmm.
I wanna hear well done.
Yes.
I wanna hear well done.
Yes.
The same way I said I'ma cut up whenever they say Christian Smith. Whenever he called my name and he start calling out stuff that I did, I want my good to outweigh my bad.
Come on.
And then whenever get down to the end of it, I want to say, well done.
Mm-hmm. Come on, that's good. Come on.
Say again.
Well done, thy good and faithful servant.
So that means guess what?
Mm-hmm.
When that wind get the blow.
Yes.
Let it blow.
Come on.
Let it blow. Don't focus on it. Because if you focus on it, that means he got to reach out and grab you. So that means now your faith is a little shaking.
Uh-huh.
Don't let your faith be shaking.
Mm-hmm.
He said if you had faith the size of a muscle, you could speak to the
mountain. And
right.
The mountain will move. Come on.
If you what?
Move.
All right, guess what? If you got just a little bit of faith and you can tell a mountain to move,
mm-hmm.
Imagine what big faith can do.
Uh-huh.
Imagine what big faith can do.
Yes.
When I tell you what big faith can do, big faith can do whenever you like mailed in your rent money. And the mail that lost your rent money. And the man called you and said, I still ain't got it. Guess what you do? Lord, you know I did what I had to do. But I'm gonna put this tracer on and you still gonna keep me. Had it to happen. There was a time fear would have grabbed me.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh Lord, here we go. I gotta find a place to meet my kids, I gotta do this and I gotta do that. No. That person don't live here no more. You know why she don't live here no more? Because now I got my eyes where it need to be focused. That was just a piece of wind to blow. In January, my mama had a stroke.
Mm.
I was at work all night long.
Mm-hmm.
Got in and I kept looking. And she kept talking. And the more she kept talking, I kept looking. First of all, I just told you I do health care for a living. Your face don't look right. Keep talking, baby. How was your night? Hold that thought. Come on, let's get you dressed. You better go to the hospital. Let me take her to the school, and I'm going to take you to go get checked. Let me tell you something. There was a time I picked up the phone and I'd have called you. Well, I'm not calling you. Did you get a call? There was a time I'd have picked up the phone and I'd have called North Carolina and told my aunts, I need y'all to come down here. Did I pick up a phone and call them? I ain't have time to call them. I had to talk to who I had to talk to. I had to talk to my father.
Come on,
I had to keep on walking. I had to believe whenever I got her in that car and I took her to that school, she was going to be okay.
Yes.
Because I know from doing healthcare, between that time frame, she could have been seriously damaged. But one thing I do know, she walking.
Mm-hmm.
She's talking.
Come on.
And she's still moving.
Yes.
And guess what else? She's still taking care of herself. I don't have to do it.
Yes.
And I go to work, I'm babying somebody else's mom and daddy that can't take care of themselves. So you know what? That walk that I said, you got to keep the eyes on them. Keep the eyes on them, young people.
Yes.
Keep the eyes on them, because trust me, that was what? Some wind.
That's right.
It knocked me down, and I didn't get focused on it. I had to keep my eyes on Jesus. We got to keep our eyes on Jesus. Don't lose your focus. Even to this day and time, a lot of times we as adults and children deal with different things. Whenever these things come, I want you to look at it and say, you just the wind. I got to keep on moving. I'm waiting for my greater reward. My reward is at the end.
Yeah.
Hold on to it. Don't move out. Keep focused. God bless you.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. That was deep.
Amen. Stay focused. Wow. All right. I'm going to be funny real quick before I open the doors. I sort of grabbed the mic to use the mic because we streamed live. And the whole time she had the mic,
she just waving her hands and running her mouth. Every now and then she'd get loud. And every time I thought she was bringing the mic to her mouth, she didn't.
But amen. Thank God for that. And I said that because I wanted to see how focused y'all really were. Thank God for the message today. How many of y'all know that every now and then Jesus will show up and he would walk and it would look like that you seeing a ghost, but it's not a ghost. You think it's a spirit, but it's not a spirit. And when you realize who he is and you ask him to let you come to him, and when you start going, you lose focus. God bless you. And when you lose focus, you start thinking about the stuff you're going through, because he'll come to you right when all hell has broken loose. The hurricane is at its worst, and you're dealing with all the issues that are there, and you may focus on it as long as you're looking at Jesus, but the moment you forget that Jesus is in front of you, and you start thinking about what you ain't got, you start thinking about how bad things really are, you start concerning yourself with what it is you know you need to do, but the whole while you're walking to him, you're not concerned and he keeping you, you ain't worried about it, the folk ain't calling you, they ain't following you, phone will stop ringing, you ain't getting emails, you ain't getting the mail coming in the mail saying this, that, and the third, but the moment you lose focus, all of a sudden the phone start ringing again. Come on, y'all ever been like that?
Amen.
Moment you lose focus, somebody remind you on the job, mama to call you, child, did the people call yet? They ain't bother you? Anybody put a notice on the door yet? Come on, y'all.
Amen.
Because see, you just started removing your eyes from him, and you started looking at the winds and the waves. You started listening at the lightning and the thunder, and you lost focus, and now you're starting to sink down. Now you're starting to go under the water, and you're getting so far under the water that Jesus saw you sinking, and you say, Lord, carry, and Jesus reached down and picked you up.
Amen. Right.
Why wait till you start sinking for him to pick you up? Why not stay up so you don't have to sink?
That's right.
That's right, yes.
So we open the doors today. We offer Christ to you today. We extend the invitation of discipleship. There may be somebody in this place today, whether young or old. We extend the invitation. He still said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest.
Amen.
He still said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm low and meek in heart, and you'll find rest unto your souls. He still said, my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Is that one today?
Amen.
You know, in the country they will say, oh, whosoever will, let him come, let him come. Say, whosoever will, let him come, let him come. Say, whosoever will, let him come, let him come. From the life-giving stream. Anybody here today know that? Say, whosoever will, let him come, let him come. Jesus said, whosoever will, let him come, let him come. Say, whosoever will, let him come, let him come. And they were singing that. And drink from the life-giving stream. I thought my daddy was singing in the country, y'all. So we offer Christ to you today.
Amen.
It's ours to offer. It's yours to accept or reject. So we thank God today for the woman of God. Give the word of God a hand today. Did y'all get something out of it today?
Amen.
Did y'all receive something from the Lord today? Children, I know y'all were like, why this woman asking us to come up to the front? Now, we comfortable where we at. We ain't got to be